I, along with Professor Puranik, welcome all of you to the question answer session. We'll start with Mufakkam Jha College, Hyderabad.
I have one question with respect to the number of grid points, because either in the laboratory or even today's discussion, it is found the selection of number of grid points is quite critical. But generally, the higher the number of grid points, we get more accurate the results. So, how do we decide about the number of grid points for a given problem?
That's a very important question. Question is, in a particular simulation, let us say today we have done a lab where you have used a grid size. So how do we decide about the number of grid size for a particular problem? Now the answer to this question is that we do a study which is called as grid independent study. In tomorrow's lab session, we had given you a problem where we have mentioned what grid independent study is. So you know that there are certain approximations which we are using, like surface averaging, volume averaging, piecewise linear approximations. So for this approximations to be accurate enough, the size of the control volume needs to be small enough. Now when we say small enough, it's a qualitative information. So we do not know what is the level of small enough we need to capture the results accurately for a particular problem. So because we exactly don't know what is, how much is the action in a particular problem, how much is the gradient of temperature and velocity in a particular problem. So when we take up a problem, we start with a grid size which we believe that the grid size results in a control volumes which are small enough. However, we are not sure, then we need to do a second run where we use a larger number of grid size and then check that the results which we have got from the larger number of grid size as compared to the smaller number of grid size, whether the change in the qualitative as well as quantitative results are negligible. If that is so, we say that the grids which we have taken earlier is good enough for that particular problem. But the number of grids varies from problem to problem. It varies from the value of the governing parameters which you are taking in a problem. So this is decided based on a grid independent study. Thank you.
I have just another clarification. Today morning, if I remember, you have discussed about this slug flow, where the temperatures at the wall and at the entrance are given, and the temporary profiles have been drawn, but there should be a condition that the entrance temperature is higher than the wall temperature. Otherwise, if it is less, the profiles would come in reverse manner.
Today morning, I had taken this problem. So the question is that the inlet temperature, I had mentioned that the wall temperature is greater than the inlet temperature. So the question is that doesn't seem to be correct, because in that case, if the inlet temperature is less than the wall temperature, then this profile should not come. No, that is not the case. Here in this case, let me remind you that here we are not plotting the temperature profile, the dimensional temperature profile. What has been plotted in the next slide is theta, not T. Theta is a non-dimensional temperature, and I would like to draw your attention that theta has been defined in this way. Okay. What you are saying is correct if it is temperature, dimensional form, whereas we are plotting the non-dimensional form of the temperature. Thank you.
What will be the case that we should mention the condition whether T infinity is greater than TW or not? Based upon that only, the profiles will change, isn't it?
Actually, the profile which I am showing you corresponds to what it will also corresponds to a case if T infinity is greater than TW. It is just that it is independent whether it is, which one is greater. But the way it has been non-dimensionalized, this is the results which you will get. But just for physical explanation, I had taken one of the case saying that the inlet temperature is greater than wall temperature. But if you do non-dimensionalize this way, the results are indeed applicable whether T infinity is greater than TW or whether TW is greater than T infinity.
Another question, sir. Can you suggest any book which deals with the numerical analysis in CFD? Because anyway, most of the books, they deal with the numerical methods. So, can you suggest any book on numerical analysis, which is normally not discussed here?
So, the question is, in this course, mostly we are discussing numerical methods, not the numerical analysis. If you see most of the CFD books, they discuss numerical methods and partly they discuss numerical analysis also. Like if you follow the book of J.D. Anderson, where he has done the stability analysis, he has shown what is numerical diffusion. Also, if you follow the book of Peric and Furziger, you can see the order of convergence, which is a part of a numerical analysis he had shown. So, these are the two books which are coming to my mind. Maybe Professor Puranik can add to it.
So there is one book by Tannehill, Anderson and Pletcher, which is called Computational Fluid Mechanics and Heat Transfer. Let me just write this on the tablet here. At least I'll write the author's names. And this is available in Indian edition. This book has a sufficient amount of numerical analysis. But let me just add quickly that typically the numerical analysis that you will see in either this one or the Anderson's book will be usually with respect to the finite differencing more than on finite volume. So for finite volume technique, the little bit that you will see is in the book by Furziger and Peric. So let me write that also. And I think the title of the second book is Computational Methods for Fluid Dynamics, I think, or something of that sort. The authors are correct.
Sir, what is the book for fluid mechanics, sir? What is the book for fluid mechanics to go through?
So the question is what's a reasonable good book for fluid mechanics? If you go back to my set of slides in part one, I had mentioned I think three good undergraduate fluid mechanics books. But what I'll request is that if you just hold on to it for a few days, at the end of the workshop we are going to upload one document on Moodle, which that file will contain actually a much exhaustive list of textbooks for both fluid mechanics as well as for the CFD. And we'll also try to write maybe one line about that book as to what level it is and typically what is good about that book and so on. So if you don't mind just waiting for a few more days, at the end of the workshop, we will upload one file on Moodle where we'll include all this information. Thank you.
Yes, M.A.S. Pillai now, New Panvel, please ask the question.
Good afternoon, Professor Sharma. My question is regarding the length scale, selection of length scale. Please refer to topic 2, slide number 5 on grid generation. My question is how to select delta x and delta y, which is control volume size basically, and which indirectly decides the computational resources. So how do you exactly decide on that? Is there any limitation on the length scale?
The question is how to decide the grid size delta x and delta y for a particular problem. Now this decision based on our, as I said, that CFD is basically guided by the fluid mechanics principles. So when we want to decide the size of the grid, we need to have an understanding of the fluid mechanics for that problem. We need to have understanding of in which region most of the fluid dynamic action is happening. Let us say for flow over a flat plate, most of the action occurs close to the flat plate. So we need to have a very fine, let us say delta y. We can have a larger delta x because in the axial direction the change in the velocities, the velocity gradients are much smaller as compared to the velocity gradients in the transverse directions. So this is the way for, so this answer to this is the decision making varies from problem to problem. because each problem has its own fluid dynamic story, and based on that understanding, we try to place, we decide the size of the grids. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Sir, I have one more question. In problems where the boundary layers are addressed, where in practically solving the problems, we need to give some thickness of boundary layer, Y plus condition is to be given. So, what are the guidelines for that?
So, the question is that especially when you are solving turbulent flow simulations, let us say for flow over a flat plate, then there are specific theory or as far as CFD is concerned for turbulent flows, where we based on the Y plus values, we decide that the number of grid points. So, the question is that how do we decide in case of turbulent flow? Sorry, I will not be able to answer this question because I had not worked on turbulent flow simulations, but whatever limited I know that based on Y plus, we make a decision about the number of grid points. Maybe Professor Puranik will add to what I had added.
Yeah, let me just quickly add to that. See, the decision on the Y plus as to how much refinement you want near the solid surface, let us say, to resolve the boundary layer, it actually depends upon the turbulence model that you are employing. Usually, if you decide to choose one particular turbulence model, normally there is sufficient literature available on how to choose the grid size that is suitable for that particular turbulence model. So, unfortunately, there cannot be any universal answer to that. It depends somewhat on the turbulence model that is being used. But roughly speaking, we want to resolve as close to the wall, and roughly speaking, Y plus of about 5 to 7 is what you need to go to in order to resolve the boundary layer completely. It may not be possible to do it computationally because the resources may be required very high. But in general, the objective is roughly to resolve up to a Y plus of about 10. Is what I have typically seen.
PhD Coimbatore.
So I have the question, the topic number 3, slide number 8. So it is regarding the special topics in computational heat conduction. In that, in the implementation details for grid points, for the heat fluxes and temperature, the heat flux along the tangential direction at the node j comma I max minus 1 is equal to tangential heat flux at the node j comma 1. Will you please explain me that using the whiteboards?
So the question is, we have taken a problem on the cylindrical coordinate system, cylindrical polar coordinate system, R phi coordinate system, and I had mentioned that this is a physical domain, we solve in this physical domain. However, for ease in scrolling through the grid points, we convert this into a computational domain which seems to be in quotient coordinate system, but this is only for the programming purpose. We have converted into this so that we can scroll through all the grid points easily. Now, in this, let me explain you the question here is that in the pseudocode I had mentioned that the heat flux in the angular direction at I max minus 1 is equal to the heat flux at 1, I is equals to 1. So, let me show you what is heat, so I here in this case is representing the angular direction, j is representing the radial direction. So, what we do is that if you go to the next slide, first we calculate the heat flux and the angular direction at I is equals to 1. And the way we calculate is, so the heat flux at I is equals to 1, to calculate that we take the temperature here which is at I is equals to 2, which is shown here, temperature at I is equals to 2 minus temperature at I max minus 1. So, you can say that the we are taking the difference of the left border cell and the right border cell. Because in this problem, there is continuity in the angular direction. However, for programming simplicity, we have broken it we have done a what you call as branch cut, but to calculate the gradient, we take the left border cell subtraction, we subtract the left border cell minus the right border cell value and divide it by the distance between the these two border cell. And note, let me remind you that the distance comes from the physical domain, and that way we calculate heat flux in the angular direction at 1. Now, once you have calculated this, in the this phase is actually physically same as this phase. I will show you in the next slide. The green line, the green line which I am showing you here is where, what is the branch cut. You can see physically it is the same line. Computationally we have broken into two parts. So, what I mean to say that this point is same as this point. So, that is the reason that in the next slide we are putting heat flux at I max minus 1 is equal to heat flux at I is equals to 1. Thank you.
Sir, the same problem if you do it in finite difference technique, finite difference method, there again if we have the continuity condition in the circumferential direction, for example, instead of temperature and if we have pressure, how to approach that problem, that is the boundary condition, fixing the boundary condition.
So, the question is that instead of temperature, if we are solving this problem for fluid flow, then instead of temperature, let us suppose if there is a variable pressure. Now, let me tell you that in the Navier-Stokes equation, although I had not discussed it till now, but the pressure equation which we solve, which we will discuss maybe tomorrow, is a Poisson equation. And in that equation is also like a heat conduction equation with volumetric heat generation. So, in that case also we calculate this way only, the way whatever has been discussed here, this is what is called as a periodic type of boundary condition, because there is a continuity along the angular direction. So, the procedure which is discussed here, similar procedure is used as far as handling pressure is concerned. Thank you.
Sir, excuse me, that here in the when you convert this the radial coordinates, and that is in the circular domain, when you convert the circular domain into rectangular domain, what is that the left hand most the squares, that is with green color indicates, what is the right most line with squares, the green color indicates, sir.
So the question is that what is the green square on the left boundary of this domain and the right boundary of the domain represent. I had mentioned that just for simplicity in deciding the running indices of the faces of the control volume, because the way we are programming the codes we have given, we are doing what you can say physics based formulation and programming. So, on the faces, you know there are two faces, two types of faces in a standard coordinate system. Like in a Cartesian coordinate system, there is vertical face centers and horizontal face center. We have heat flux in the x direction on horizontal face center, vertical face center, and heat flux in the y direction on the horizontal face center. So, the green square which is shown here is just for you, that from this picture you get an idea that these are the face center you have to scroll through to calculate the heat fluxes in the x direction for Cartesian coordinate system and heat flux in the angular direction in cylindrical polar coordinate system. Now, in this case I will repeat again that as there is an angular continuity, when you make a branch cut and convert into this form, this boundary physically is same as this boundary. It is just like if you take a paper and rotate the two ends, you get a circle. Okay. So, this is the grid point for heat flux in the angular direction.
Sir, so one more question. Here we have equated the tangential heat flux at the J minus 1, I max minus 1 with the heat flux in the tangential direction at the node 1, that is I is equal to 1. In between, there is a heat flux in the tangential direction at the node I max. What is the relation between the heat flux in the tangential direction at the node I max with the heat fluxes in the tangential direction at the nodes I max minus 1 and 1.
So, the question is what is the relationship between the Q at I max with the Q at I max minus 1. Let me tell you the way we have used the convention, the running indices for the east face of a control volume is equal to the running indices of the centroid of the control volume. So, the last green square which you see is this one, and what is the running indices of the corresponding centroid of the control volume? It is I max minus 1. So, in our program, if you go and see, in the angular direction, Q at I max does not come into the expression. Q at I max minus 1 is the last value. So, Q at I max is not needed. Thank you. VPCOE, Erode.
My question is purely application oriented. Just I want to check that whether this problem can be applied by a CFD or not. Okay. Right. I hope you are aware about the cooling towers. Then the conventional cooling towers, what's happening? The hot water is sprayed from the top of the cooling tower, and water is drawn from the ambient temperature, water is drawn from the bottom of the cooling tower. So that two-phase flow is taking place. But in case of the three-phase fluidized bed cooling tower, I hope you are aware about this three-phase fluidized bed cooling tower, in which in addition to the hot water and ambient temperature air, in between these two, we are creating a fluidization zone where some plastic balls of different diameters are introduced into fluidization bed, so that the hot water while sprayed from the top of the cooling tower, the heat transfer surface area being increased by the plastic balls, so that the heat transfer enhancement is taking place. This is the problem. My question is whether, since it is a multi-phase flow, that is three-phase flow, hot water, that is liquid, solid and vapor, multi-phase flow is taking place, is it possible to find out the temperature profile of the water across the bed height, fluidization bed height, number one? Number two, is it possible to get the fluidization velocity profile across the fluidization zone? This is my question. My question is, that's the second, next question is, can we apply the CFD concept, CFD analysis to this problem, sir? Please help me. Thank you.
The question is different from what is there in the lecture slide. It is more of an application. The question is whether the CFD tools can be applied in case of three phase flow, where there is a solid, there is a liquid, there is a vapor, and the system which is being talked about is the fluidized bed. Although I had not done that type of simulation, I had done a multi-phase flow simulation where vapor and liquid is involved, but whatever limited literature I had seen in this regard, I can say, I had seen that CFD has a capability to do this. So, I will stop with this limited answer. Thank you. VPCOE Baramati.
Sir, my question is, what is the effect of Reynolds number and Prandtl number on the steady state temperature conditions contour, or what is the significance of these two numbers?
So, the question is, what is the effect of Prandtl number and Reynolds number on temperature contours? So, I need actually more specification on the problem, meaning if you are talking about a conduction type situation or in a fluid flow. So, can you please say little more about the problem?
This is regarding the convection type of flow, fluid flow.
Okay, so it's related to convection type of flow. So the nature of the Reynolds number, sorry, the value of the Reynolds number rather, would decide what sort of a flow situation that we are dealing with, whether it is a turbulent flow or whether it is going to be a laminar flow, as we know. And the Prandtl number usually decides the extent of the boundary layers that are formed for the hydrodynamic situation as well as the thermal situation. So, roughly the ratio of the boundary layers for hydrodynamic to thermal situations is what is given by the Prandtl number. In that sense, the temperature contours, you cannot explicitly tell what's going to be the effect of Reynolds number and Prandtl number, but the two parameters will definitely determine what sort of a temperature field and a flow field is going to be decided in your situation, and thereby the eventual temperature contours will be decided. In that sense, it's not very possible for me to say that it's going to be only this kind of effect or that kind of effect. They are going to be definitely affecting the flow as well as heat transfer, but specific effect on the temperature contours is somewhat difficult to answer. Let me ask Professor Sharma if he has any comment on this to add.
The product of the Reynolds number and Prandtl number comes out as a what we call a speculate number, and when you look into the non-dimensional equation in heat transfer, convective heat transfer, 1 by Reynolds number into Prandtl number, that is 1 by Peclet number, comes as a diffusion coefficient in the equation. So, if the product of the Reynolds number multiplied by Prandtl number is more, then the inverse of that is less. So, in that case, diffusion is less or conduction heat transfer is less as compared to advection heat transfer or vice versa. Thank you. So, it has a relationship with the relative magnitude of conduction heat transfer with advection heat transfer. Amrita School of Engineering, Kollam.
So, this is regarding the convergence criteria that we said. We are forced to set the convergence criteria as the RMS value of the error. Sir, is it possible to, if I need the error at a point to be limited for a particular reason, I need the value at a location, then can I set the convergence criteria that the error at that point or at that plane is in a limit?
So, I think the question is on the way we define the convergence criteria. I had defined in a some way where I had calculated the RMS value. I think Professor Puranik had defined in a slightly different way. People define that term in a different ways, but that is fine. It's just that that maximum difference between each grid point, the temperature difference which Professor Puranik has mentioned, it's a more stringent criteria. This so it may happen that in that case, if a solution is converged by let us say at 10 to power minus 3, if you take the RMS value, it may be 10 to power minus 4, but both are considered good enough. So, but there are certain problems where taking the RMS values is considered better. So, that is why as per my experience, I had used this, proposed this type of convergence criteria. Yeah, I would like to mention that in your question, you have said that take the difference of the temperature at one point. I would like to point out it is not at one point. If there are, let us say, 25 grid points inside the domain, then we get the 25 difference, we take the temperature difference of those 25 grid points between the two consecutive time step, and among those 25 difference values, we pick up the maximum difference and check whether that maximum difference is practically zero. Thank you. VIT Pune.
Under free convection over the object like sphere, how to take boundary conditions and how to decide the size of the domain?
So, the question is that for a free convection situation, that to an external flow in an open domain, free convection, let us say across a cylinder in an open domain, how to decide the size of the domain. Typically, in such situation, a very large domain is taken, and in that case, the boundary conditions which are used are at the boundary there will be some out, depending upon a particular problem, we will come to know that, let us suppose if you take a hot cylinder, due to buoyancy, the fluid will rise, and so the top boundary of the domain will have an outflow boundary conditions. And below, we try to take a much larger upstream distance, and however, the domain size which we take, as I said, that the size of the domain, there are various problems in CFD, especially in external flow problems. We take a size of the domain, we get a results. However, we are not sure that whether the size of the domain is correct enough to give the accurate results. So, we increase the size of the domain and do a second simulation and check whether the difference between the results is whether there is a difference between the results in two different domains, and if it is not, then we say that the grid size, the domain size is good enough. Thank you.
Hello sir, one more question is there. Topic number 5, slide number 4. Topic number 5, slide number 4. In which direction fluid is flowing and what is the direction of heat flow?
So, the question is in which direction fluid is flowing and in which direction heat flow is occurring. This I had taken a convective heat transfer problem and I had taken 4 different cases. Case 1 where the flow is from the ice side, I had taken an example, you are standing between, let us say, ice at 0 degree centigrade, fire at 100 degree centigrade, and I had taken 4 different cases. So, in the first case, flow is from left to right. In the second case, flow is again from left to right. In the third case and fourth case, you can see that the velocity is in the negative direction. It has a negative value. So, the flow is in the negative direction. So, the first answer to the first part of the question is, in first and second case, flow is in positive x direction. And in the second case, flow is in the negative x direction. Now, as far as the direction of the heat flow is concerned, the direction of heat flow is always from higher temperature to a lower temperature. Although when you have a flow, it carries along with it the enthalpy and it is transported in the flow direction. Thank you.
So, from the same topic, slide number 15, is there any relation between delta and delta 3? Is there any correlation which defines the two, or they are totally independent variables?
Question is whether there is a relationship between the boundary layer thickness and velocity boundary layer thickness and thermal boundary layer thickness. Yes, there is a relationship, and in fact it has a relationship with a non-dimensional number, Prandtl number. Okay, Prandtl number is defined as a ratio of kinematic viscosity divided by thermal diffusivity, and I had mentioned that this is a direct correlation with kinematic viscosity and this with thermal diffusivity. Okay, so Prandtl has a relationship with growth of this. So, when the Prandtl number is more, then the velocity boundary layer thickness is more as compared to thermal boundary layer thickness and vice versa.
Again, one more question.
Hello sir, under free convection, you said that size of the domain we have to take very large size. But I have not followed how to take boundary conditions, which boundary conditions we have to exactly select.
So, the question is what boundary condition one has to take in a natural convection problem. Actually, the boundary condition varies from problem to problem, natural convection problem. So, I had been very generic in answering that question. I had taken a case where let us suppose there is a sphere or there is a cylinder which is heated and due to buoyancy there is a plume which is formed and the it tries to rise upwards. So, then I had said you can take a top boundary where you can use an outflow boundary conditions, and I had said you take a bottom boundary where you take u is equals to 0 and v is equals to 0, and you can take the side boundary where you can use the far field boundary conditions. Thank you. Professor Puranik will add to this.
Yeah, just a quick addition to that, and typically these natural convection problems when you are solving, you end up taking a sufficiently large domain and the object size is much smaller than the domain, and having chosen such a large domain, usually the free stream conditions you can safely assume at least on 3 of the 4 boundaries. And the top boundary is usually taken as an outflow type situation, but the side and the bottom boundary, if it is sufficiently far from the object which is losing heat by natural convection, I think it is reasonably safe to take free stream conditions as the boundary conditions. I think that's what makes sense to me. Thank you.
Sir, the question is about upwinding. How that can be good for compressible flow, especially just interested in how that upwinding is better for compressible flows.
So let me try to answer that because I have some experience in compressible flows. See, usually, so the question is, how is upwinding good for compressible flows? And what I'll do is I'll try to give a purely physics-based answer. So if you see compressible flows, typically what we are dealing with is that the advection is much, much stronger than the diffusion, so that there is a clear direction established by the flow as far as the momentum transfer is concerned. So if you see, let us say, from a computational standpoint, you are looking at a finite volume situation, and you consider a cell face between two adjacent cells. So as far as this cell interface or cell face is concerned, depending on which side is the more dominant in terms of the fluid flow, you can choose the upwinding, so that if the flow is strong enough from left to right or right to left, you want your numerical method rather to mimic that as cleanly as it can. And that's the reason we end up choosing upwinding when we go for compressible flow situations. So the answer really is in the fact that the advection is very strong compared to diffusion in case of typical compressible flows. Thank you.
Periyar Tanjavur, please ask your question.
Sir, throughout the kinematics, we have come across some stream function and all other topics, but we don't cross anything about potential function. It's less important in CFD, sir. Yeah, that is, we never come across anything about potential functions. We have come across the stream functions and all. So wouldn't we talk about the potential function?
Yeah, so the question is on the use of potential functions. What is getting pointed out is that during the kinematics, we have talked about stream functions, but we haven't talked about potential function. So the answer is that the potential function has a restricted use, in the sense that only under irrotational conditions you can use the potential function to define the velocities with the use of a gradient of potential function. But it is restricted to only irrotational flows. And in general, irrotational flows forms a very small class of fluid mechanics. And that's the reason we don't really have to deal with potential functions much. On the other hand, stream function is something that has slightly more general usage, at least as far as two-dimensional situations are concerned, in the sense that you can utilize that to plot streamlines as well. And perhaps that's the reason stream function is used more, but potential functions is restricted only to some cases, which are these irrotational flow cases. Nirma University, Ahmedabad, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. I have a question in topic number 4, slide number 38, to Sharma sir. What is the reason for unbounded solution for SOU and quick C?
The question is that what is the reason for unboundedness in second order upwind scheme and second order upwind and quick scheme? If you remember that I had taken a lecture of steady state one dimensional advection, steady state one dimensional convection, and where I had shown you that when you use a central difference scheme and when the Peclet number is greater than 2, then there for that scheme I had shown you that there is an unboundedness, okay, or there is an oscillation. So that is similar thing happens in case of quick scheme and second order scheme, which results in unboundedness solution. So the relationship between the coefficients which are involved, the neighboring coefficients, is such that it results in oscillations, unboundedness on a coarser grid. Thank you.
Okay, one more question. You mentioned about numerical diffusion today. What is the significance or reason for that?
The question is, today I mentioned that first order upwind has a numerical diffusion. Now, the question is that what is the mathematically we can understand as far as the numerical diffusion is concerned. I would had not shown taken the background of those, that's typically done in a numerical analysis. However, I would suggest you that if you go follow the book of computational fluid dynamics by J.D. Anderson, there they had shown that if you use a first order upwind scheme, there are certain terms which comes into the expression which gives rise to the numerical diffusion. Maybe Professor Puranik will add to it.
Let me just add to that numerical diffusion part. And if you read this Anderson's or something similar, again the discussion would be based on a finite difference technique, and depending on the Taylor series expansions and the number of terms taken or refused in the Taylor series expansion and so on. What I'd like to point out on a purely physical basis, since the question was the significance of numerical diffusion, the reason I'm trying to point this out is because this is something that we routinely encounter in compressible flows. So, for example, in a compressible flow, there is an occurrence of something called a shock, which is essentially a discontinuity in flow variables. So your numerical method ideally would like to capture a shock as a discontinuity, which is essentially a sharp change over practically no distance. However, if you end up using first order upwind schemes, what happens is that this discontinuity gets smeared over a certain distance, and this is what we call numerical diffusion. So the numerical method is unable to capture exactly the kind of discontinuity that occurs in a real life situation. Rather, it smears it over a sufficient distance, and that is what on a purely physical basis, if you want to look at the effect of diffusion on flow solutions, I think that's a good example to look at. Thank you.
Amrita Coimbatore, please ask the question.
Sir, my question is regarding topic number 4, slide number 38, where you have given a comparison between all the schemes to capture the shock wave. If you see the comparison between the first order of winding and quick schemes, especially for a coarser grid, quick scheme can capture the shock, but it was not accurate, especially away from the shock. So that case, why can't we use the quick scheme near the shock? And why can't you couple the quick scheme with first order of winding away from the shock wave?
So the question is to use a scheme which is something like a hybrid scheme, which is being said that let us use quick scheme near to the sharp change, and the oscillation is the quick scheme is it is being pointed out is able to capture the sharp change better than first order upwind scheme. So what is being suggested is that why not use this quick scheme in this region, and wherever oscillation is occurring, why not use first order upwind scheme? I had not used it, and I have a serious doubt whether you will get an accurate solution, because first order upwind may smear the solution all through the domain. Professor Puranik will add to it.
Let me just add to it based on my experience with compressible flows. Usually when you are computing a solution where situations such as shocks are expected, a priori or beforehand, you don't necessarily know where the shocks are going to come. So in that sense, it is essentially impossible to design a hybrid scheme such as what you are referring to. However, there is a very standard approach that is employed along with these quick type schemes. And that is what is called as a flux limiter approach, which results into what is called as a total variation diminishing or TVD type schemes. That is usually a slightly more advanced topic than what we have been covering. However, a reasonably good discussion of these TVD approaches using the flux limiters to essentially limit the oscillations that the higher order schemes like quick are introducing near discontinuities, you can find in the finite volume book by Versteg and Malalasekara. But I think I'd like to limit my answers to only that, because it's slightly out of the scope. But your point is well taken, but there is a well-known fix for it, and that is what is done in terms of these TVD schemes using the flux limiter approaches. So Thanks. KIT, go ahead, please.
Sir, I have three questions. First one is, in between the two finite volumes, the variation of that variables, we have taken a linear. If the non-linearity in the variables are present, can we catch by making some modification in the schemes? This is my first question. And second question is, when we are operating the codes in case of the labs, when the iterations are going on, one word I observed, that is unsteadiness continuously. What is the meaning of that unsteadiness? And the third question is, I want one suggestion from your side, sir. If the chemical kinetics is present in the process, and which scheme is better?
Okay, so there are three questions. First question is, in an advection scheme, you remember that we had used linear variation in case of second order upwind. So, second order upwind is a linear extrapolation scheme, central difference is a linear interpolation scheme. So, the question is that when we assume locally linear variation, in fact, not only in this advection scheme, for conduction or diffusion also we have used piecewise linear approximations. So, the question is that if the variation is non-linear, how good is this linear approximation? I would like you to point out to the figure which I had drawn, a simple figure, a non-linear function f of x as a function as x varies. If you remember, I had drawn a very non-linear function and I had pointed out that however non-linear a function may be, if you take a very small delta x, within that small delta x, even the function is highly non-linear, even then locally linear approximations are good enough. Note that in computational fluid dynamics, anyway we have to do a grid independent study, anyway we have to take a very small grid size, and in a very small grid size, this linear variations are very common in computational fluid dynamics and they indeed work well. This is answer to the first question. In the second question, in the lab codes, there is a word which I had used, unsteadiness. I think this is the right word. Yesterday it was pointed out that in my lecture slide, I am using a word convergence for the unsteady state problem. So, I think this is the right word. Instead of using word convergence criteria, I should say it is an unsteadiness criteria. So, in the code, a term has been defined unsteadiness. So, what we do is that we calculate the root mean square value of temperature and compare with that unsteadiness value. That unsteadiness value we ideally want to reach to 0, but computer does not know what 0 is. So, we say that unsteadiness is 10 to power minus 3 or 10 to power minus 4. So, as you know that in unsteady state code, the code stops when this unsteadiness criteria is fulfilled, or unsteadiness is of the order of 10 to power minus 3 or 10 to power minus 4. Regarding the third question, chemical kinetics, what are the types of schemes which are used? Honestly speaking, I do not have any experience and exposure to this. So, I will not be able to answer this. Professor Puranik will.
Yeah, I have a very limited exposure to chemical kinetics, specifically related to hypersonic flow, where the air is undergoing dissociation type reaction. So, that type of a chemical kinetics is what I have some experience with. But in general, the characteristics of other combustion type reactions also are more or less similar. So, the answer to your question is that, see, whenever you are including chemical kinetics in your CFD type simulation, usually you will end up adding convection diffusion equations with a source term, which will describe that chemical kinetics. So, finally, you are still dealing with an advection term, a diffusion term and a source term. So, there is absolutely no difference between numerical treatment of those terms than what you have seen here. So, typical advection schemes that you have already seen, such as quick or first order upwind or second order upwind, you can utilize for even the use of discretization of the chemical kinetics equations. Similarly, the diffusion part in the chemical kinetics equations is usually differenced in the central difference form. So whatever you have seen already, you can utilize it for chemical kinetics also. Thank you.
NIT Warangal.
Yeah, here I have a doubt about analogy in the topic number 4, slide number 30 for Dr. Atul Sharma sir. And in that, quadratic upwind interpolation convection kinematics, I have some doubt about for getting that analogy, whereas phi e is equal to 3 phi e plus 6 phi p minus phi w whole by 8. If possible, can you try to please elaborate this? And this is my first question. And my second question, and if possible, can you provide one example about fluid structure interface by using of CFD analogy?
Okay, the first, there are two questions. First question is on this slide. I had shown that while using the quick scheme, these are the expression. These are the usual expression when there is a uniform distance between the grid points. Here, let me come to this expression and talk about it. Here we have taken a case where mass flow rate is in the positive x direction and the positive y direction. And in this case, so effectively there is a flow is inclined upward. So that if you take its component, you get mass flux in the x positive x direction, mass flux in the positive y direction. Now, in the phase, you know if the flow direction is positive x direction, then this is the downstream neighbor. And in a quick scheme, I would like to remind that in a quick scheme, the weight which we give to the downstream neighbor is 3 by 8, which is shown here. This is the upstream neighbor. And the weight which we give is 3 by 4 or 6 by 8, which is given here. And the weight we give to upstream of upstream neighbor is minus 1 by 8. This is the usual expression whose derivation I had shown in the previous slide. That is being used here. And when you go to the west face, the downstream neighbor is phi p, upstream is phi w, and upstream of upstream is phi ww. That is what is shown here. Similarly, it is done for the south face center and the north face center. And regarding the second question is different from what has been taught here. For the fluid structure interface, the question is how in CFD we take care of those. There is a method which is now becoming quite popular, which is called as a immersed boundary method, where instead of a body fitted grid, a Cartesian grid is laid down, and when the object moves, the good thing about this Cartesian grid is that you do not have to do remeshing after each time step. Then in that case, as far as fluid structure interface is concerned, when the solid object moves, it transports certain momentum to the fluid, which needs to be accounted for. So the answer to your question is that as far as handling fluid structure interface is concerned, whenever a solid moves in a fluid, it not only transports momentum, but it also leads to a mass transfer across a control volume, which is fixed in space. So these are the two things which needs to be taken in account as far as the fluid solid interface is concerned. Thank you. Truba College, Indore, please ask the question.
Sir, my question is, what is the difference between discretization error and round off error?
So the question is, what is the difference between discretization error and a round off error? Now, let me answer this question in a finite difference for finite difference method. In a finite difference method, if you go back and see how the central difference approximation was applied, there in finite difference method, a Taylor series expansion is done, and from the Taylor series expansion, we try to get difference equation for, let us say, del phi by del x by forward difference or backward difference. So when we use Taylor series expansion and when you try to get a finite difference equation, other than the finite difference equation, you will see the remaining terms which have the higher order derivatives. So, that those terms are called as truncated terms, and in those truncated term, the lowest power of, let us say, if it is a Taylor series expansion in the x direction, then the lowest power of delta x which is there, it is called as a discretization, order of discretization error, discretization error. And the truncated terms gives the discretization error. Now, as far as the round off error is concerned, so the round off error comes that when you are using computer, and then computer, you know that it has certain precision, single precision or double precision. So, after a certain decimal, it truncates the value. So, this gives rise to the round off error. So, overall I can say that discretization comes when we do the discretization, whether it is a finite difference discretization or a finite volume discretization, there is an approximation which is used which leads to a discretization error, where round off error just comes from when you operate with the computer which has a finite precision. Thank you.
Yeah, Atul, I have one question. This is regarding the I Reynolds number flows. So, when we take these I Reynolds number flows, usually when we try for any kind of this advection schemes, we try to get a numerical advection term and there is one turbulent diffusion term. So, you like when you go for a higher accuracy solutions, usually the numerical diffusion term should be lower than your turbulent diffusion term. So, what usually we do is we try to increase the or refine the computational grid, which will increase your computational power, or we will go for higher order schemes. So, when we go for higher order schemes, what we end up with? We end up with what, like the dispersive error we are going to get wherever the gradients are high. So, in this case, like what exactly we need to do actually, whether we need to go for a refining a grid or going for higher order schemes, which will be a better option?
So, the question is at higher Reynolds number, there are two strategies which are being followed. In fact, that is true for any Reynolds number. One is that you refine the grid for a using a particular advection scheme, or use the same grid size and use a higher order scheme. Now, the answer to this question is that ultimately the answer is decided by the computational cost which is involved. If using the same grid size and with a higher order scheme, you are able to achieve higher accuracy, then you have to see what is the computational cost or computational time it takes. On the other hand, if you follow the second strategy, where you use the same scheme which you are using and refine the grid, and then see what is the computational cost which is involved. So, these two strategies are there, and it varies from problem to problem. So, it is difficult to answer that which one is better, because you yourself have to do the comparison and then come to a conclusion for a particular type of problem which you are solving. Thank you.
Yeah, I have one more question. This is regarding the first level or second level approximation, what we take whenever we are dealing with either a unsteady term or advection term. So, how we like whether we are working on a surface averaging to calculate the enthalpy term, or when you come to unsteady this thing, whether we will go for volume averaging. So, can you explain a little bit on this like first level of approximation or second level approximation?
The question is on the approximations which are used in the finite volume method. Can I elaborate on this approximation? Whichever term we take, whether it is an unsteady term or advection term or diffusion term or even source term, there are two approximations which are used, and that I had called as two levels of approximation. That is just a, I had classified as two levels of approximation, because these are the two approximations which are involved. Now, either the term which we are considering, either it is directly proportional to volume like unsteady term or a source term, or there are other terms which are directly proportional to surface area, or the terms which have fluxes like advection term and diffusion term. So, the terms which have fluxes, so the terms which have fluxes are the flux is directly proportional to the surface area, the terms which are directly proportional to volume, then we need certain terms within a volume. In case of fluxes, we need the flux on a particular surface area. Now, when you take a volume or a surface area, there are infinite number of points and the flux varies on the surface point to point. If you take the source term, like if you take an unsteady term which is directly proportional to the volume, the rate of change of internal energy or rate of change of temperature varies from point to point within the volume. So, we need to have variation of that term in a volume or a surface. So, the way we had said volume averaging or surface averaging, what I mean is that we here we are following a procedure where we have to take very small control volume, very small surface area. So, rather than considering its variation, let us take one point value which is accurate enough, which is second order accurate. So, we say that in a volume, let us take the centroid of the volume. In the surface area, let us take the centroid of a surface area. And let us take the rate of change of temperature at the centroid of the control volume and let us take the fluxes at the centroid of the surface area. This is what I mean by volume and surface averaging respectively. And this is what I had called as first level of approximation. Regarding the seventh level of approximation, what happens is whenever you try to express the, let us say, flux like conduction flux or an enthalpy flux. Actually, this flux are at the faces of the control volume. Now, the expression for this fluxes consists of, let us say, either velocities or temperature. In case of diffusion, it consists of the gradient of velocity or temperature. In case of advection, it consists of value of the velocity or temperature at the face center. So, we need an approximation because finally, we want to end up with an algebraic equation where this variables are not at the faces, but we want expression where they should be expressed in terms of the cell center value. So, we need to come up with an approximation to calculate the value of this variables at the face center for advection, the normal gradient of this variables for diffusion term at the faces, for which we use a diffusion piecewise linear approximation. That is what I had called as a second level of approximation. Because by using these two approximation, we start from a control volume, apply conservation laws and end up with an algebraic equation. Thank you.
Yeah, Atul, I have one more question. Like whenever we are dealing with this Bessel number is equal to zero, so we usually what we take is like usually the advection or convection is neglected. Can we take an as a pure conduction case? So whenever we have that velocity being very small or the Bessel number is equal to zero, will it be a pure conduction case? Over and out.
Yes, you are right. It will, the question is that when Peclet number is zero or very close to zero, can we take it as a pure conduction? Yes, that is the correct answer because in that case advection is zero, almost zero. So it will be pure conduction case. And I had shown my lecture slide that the variation is linear in that case. Thank you. NIT Nagpur.
Sir, I have a question regarding what is a slug flow and sir, how does the slug flow, the region develops with respect to the thermally developed and how does the hydrodynamic boundary layer develops in a slug flow?
The question is regarding the slug flow. Okay, so this example I have taken for the slug flow. So, the question is that how the hydrodynamic development occurs in the slug flow. There is no hydrodynamic development in this slug flow because we have taken the flow in such a way that there is no velocity gradient. Everywhere u is u infinity and v is 0. So, there is no velocity gradient in the vertical direction, there is no velocity gradient in the horizontal direction. So, that way there is no action in the flow. This situation is hypothetical because in real world situation in a plane channel, let us say if you have a flow, there will be boundary layer growth. So, I agree that we have taken non-physical flow field, but this is an analytical solution and this is a test problem for which we have taken. So, I would say do not try to get into the physics of the flow as far as this is concerned. And as far as heat transfer is concerned, So from this, I had shown you the temperature profile at the end. So in this case, it just happens that if let us suppose the wall is hot, then this fluid which is entering at ambient temperature slowly gets heated from the wall, and as it keeps moving on, the center line temperature increases continuously, and if it is very long, finally it should reach to the wall temperature. So that is the way the thermal development occurs. Thank you.
Sir, one more question, sir, regarding plain Poiseuille flow, sir. How does the regime is defined, when the flow is fully developed, or the developing region also is defined under plain Poiseuille flow regime?
Yeah, so the question is on plain Poiseuille flow, and whether we take both the developing as well as developed regions in the plain Poiseuille flow. So the plain Poiseuille flow simply means that we are talking about flow in a parallel plate channel. In that sense, the name only suggests that we are talking about a two-dimensional channel and the flow going through it. So at least my interpretation would be that both developing as well as developed regions can be clubbed under one name, that is the plain Poiseuille flow.
I would also agree with that. Yeah.
So one more terminology I want to ask, sir, like when we talk about thermally developed, hydrodynamically developed flow and thermally developed flow, one great flow regimes come in the name I have heard. I don't know much about it. Can you please throw some light on it?
Yeah, so the question is on something called the grades flow situation, and what is exactly that? So the grades flow is actually a hydrodynamically developed but thermally developing situation. Okay, so I'll repeat once again, it's a hydrodynamically developed but thermally developing region. Professor Sharma has to say something on this.
If you look into this slug flow, the grades flow what Professor Puranik had just mentioned, you can understand with this slide, where instead of this uniform velocity profile at different axial location, if you have a fully developed parabolic velocity profile, which is a hydrodynamically fully developed velocity profile, then the same slug flow will become a grades flow. Thank you.
Does that mean that it happens only when the Peclet number is high? Will it happen in low Peclet number, not Peclet, Prandtl number? I'm talking about Prandtl numbers.
Yeah, so as I had mentioned that the Prandtl number has a relationship with the growth of the velocity boundary layer and thermal boundary layer. So let us take one case where if Prandtl number is greater than 1, then in that case the velocity development will be, so velocity boundary layer will be above the thermal boundary layer. So in that case, what will happen? What happens in case of plane channel flow is that boundary layer grows from the bottom wall, boundary layer grows from the bottom wall as well as top wall, and it meets at the center, and thereafter after some length flow becomes fully developed. So if your Prandtl number is greater than 1, which means your velocity boundary layer will be above thermal boundary layer, in that case the hydrodynamic development length will be smaller, so the flow will develop before the thermal development and vice versa. Thank you.
Yeah, let me just quickly add to that. The grades problem is possible for all Prandtl numbers. It's just that for a Prandtl number equal to 0, it will become the slug flow that what Professor Sharma has shown. So I would say that grades problem is available for all Prandtl numbers. There is no restriction on the Prandtl number in that sense.
Sir, one last question from our side. Sir, in the implementation of certain schemes, you refine the grid size. Initially, you said it is a coarse grid, and then subsequently, you said it's fine grid. So the question is, sir, how do we decide upon what is the fineness and what is the coarseness? Like, what is the limit beyond which we say now we are into a regime of, say, finer grids or fine? Well, that's a question normally asked in case of solid mechanics related problems as well. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So the question is, whenever we, so this is a question which has been asked earlier also, that how do we make a decision as far as grid size is concerned? And so the point is that we start with a grid and then we refine the grid. And the grid which we have taken in the beginning, we call that grid as a coarse grid. This is just a qualitative way, because we, let us suppose I have taken 100 by 100 and 200 by 200. But this is just a qualitative information that 100 by 100 is coarse and 200 by 200 is fine. But let us suppose if I run both the my simulation in both the grid points, and if by 100 by 100 and 200 by 200 are giving almost same result, then I can say that maybe 50 by 50 is a coarse grid and 100 and 100 is as fine as 200 by 200, because it is giving me the accurate solution. So what I am trying to tell you here is that the answer to the question that what grid we should take in a particular problem, it varies from problem to problem, and we have to do a study which is called as grid independent study. Then only we will come to know what is coarse grid, what is fine grid. Because once we get a result where further refinements in the grid does not show any change in the result, then we can say that the grid which we are using are fine. If it is leading to large change in the result, then we will say that the grid which we had taken is a coarse. So this word is a qualitatively, and the answer also varies from problem to problem. The grid size which we have to take also varies from problem to problem. Thank you. NIT Warangal.
Hello, good evening, sir. My doubt is regarding this topic number 3, slide number 8. Sir, if we are doing the CFD analysis of any circular rod, typically like spent nuclear fuel rods or some nuclear fuel rods with volumetric heat generation, we are not considering the central point. We are starting j is equals to 1 from the circle that is next to the center. And if we substitute the equation, the governing equation at the center, it will blow up to infinity. So since R is equals to 0, now if we are interested to find the temperature at the center, how are we going to deal this?
This is a very interesting question. The question is that in this slide, I had taken, let us suppose, a square plate with a circular hole. But instead of that, let us suppose if there is no hole, then what he is pointing at us that if you draw the control volume when, let us suppose, there is no hole or it is a solid rod, such as he has given an example of a nuclear rod, then near to the center, what you find is the control volume has only 3 faces. It becomes like a triangle. It does not have fourth face, because at the center, maybe I will show in the whiteboard. So let us suppose you have a circular domain, and when you draw the concentric circles and concentric radial lines also, what will happen that near to the center, you will get a control volume which is like this. Okay. So here the surface area is 0. Surface area is 0. And so in here what is happening is that you are getting a control volume where one of the surface area is 0. Now the way I suggest to work this situation is that, so when, let us suppose if it is a conduction problem, as surface area is 0 here, so the conduction heat transfer in the radial direction on this surface will be 0. And there will be, here you will have, let us say, QR plus DR. Here you have, let us say, Q phi. Here you have Q phi plus d phi. Okay. So this way you do an energy balance, then your solution will not blow up. Thank you.
Sir, if we want to find out the temperature at the center of the nuclear fuel rod, where we typically expect the maximum temperature. So how are we going to evaluate it, sir?
Okay. So the question is that if I want to calculate the temperature at the center of the nuclear rod, how we will evaluate it? Let us come back to the whiteboard again. I would like to make a correction that this is not a small q, but it should be capital Q, because the surface area is 0, heat flux is not 0. Now let me say that this is the control volume, first control volume near to the boundary. This is the second control volume near to the boundary, and this is the third control volume near to the center. So you have one grid point here, one grid point here, and one grid point here. And his question is that when we use a finite volume method, we calculate the temperature here. Let us say this is T1, let us say this is T2, and let us say this is T3. So in a finite volume method, we do not calculate temperature at phase center, we calculate at centroids of this control volume. Now the answer to this question, how to calculate temperature at this point? So in this case, we do extrapolations. Like we can take this 2 points and extrapolate here. If you want to use higher order extrapolation so that you get a more accurate result, in that case, you may have to take 3 points or 4 points. So we do one-sided extrapolation to calculate the temperature. So let us suppose this temperature is calculated as a function of T1, T2, T3, and so on, depending upon the order of extrapolation. Thank you. So we'll stop here. Thank you.